Welcome to the Author Interviews for Liberty Matters, a forum of various authors and texts available on the Online Library of Liberty. The Online Library of Liberty is part of the Liberty Fund network of websites. For more information about Liberty Fund, visit our webpage at www.libertyfund.org. I'm Pat Lynch, a senior fellow at the Liberty Fund, and today I'm joined by Judge Glock, who has written the lead essay for our December 2020 forum on A.V. Dicey. If you'd like to watch any of the other interviews by the authors from this forum or any of the other interviews in this series, please visit our YouTube channel. A link to the forum itself on the Online Library of Liberty is also on our YouTube channel. Judge Glock is a senior policy advisor at the Cicero Institute. He was formerly a visiting professor at the Department of Economics at West Virginia University. He received his PhD in history with a focus on economic history from Rutgers University. Among other places, Judge's academic writing has been featured in the Business History Review, Review of Banking and Financial Law, and Tax Notes. And his public writing has been featured in the Wall Street Journal, Chicago Tribune, and Politico, among other outlets. Judge focuses his research on areas of regulation, financial reform, and housing policy. Judge, it's a great pleasure to have you at the author interviews today for Liberty Matters. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks so much, Pat. Always a pleasure.
Well, I remember when we started talking about doing this forum a number of months ago, and you suggested Dicey, and it seems as time has gone on that rule of law and Dicey's conception of rule of law has become more and more relevant with each passing day. We're recording this on December 7th, and so I think it's very, very January timely. 7th. What's that? I'm sorry, January 7th. Yes, correct. I'm sorry. I'm thinking of Pearl Harbor Day.
Another day to live in infamy.
Unfortunately, yes. So I want to start by saying, starting to ask you, what if you could talk a little bit about Dicey the person, his career, his life, and how he came to settle on this concept of the rule of law as his main focus for his research.
Yeah, so Albert Van Dicey kind of came from a perfect amalgamation of two different strands of English thought in the 19th century. There was his father, who came from a slightly more Benthamite reformist side, kind of a classic liberal manufacturer's 19th century laissez-faire family, who worked on a series of newspapers, who promulgated sort of laissez-faire beliefs. And there was his mother, who came from a slightly more evangelical background, a much more reformist and much more moralistic background. In a way, Dicey always tried to combine these two strands throughout his life. His most important biographical moments took place when he was the vinarian professor of English law at Oxford University, which he was for 20 years. There, he wrote a number of important pieces studying English constitutional history and doing some of the first comparative constitutional studies kind of in the world. And that made him, for a while, a household name, an important British commentator, regularly cited in writing for major newspapers and journals, and still today, one of the most cited individuals in legal history. He came up, most importantly, as discussed in the piece, with the idea of the rule of law, and tried to describe what the rule of law meant for, most importantly, for Anglo-American jurisprudence, why he saw the American and British traditions as separate from, say, the French traditions, which he thought did not contain the same basic rule of law principles. And sort of now today, when people talk about the rule of law or where they talk about comparative constitutionalism, they always have to go back to Dicey. Dicey is the starting point for all of these contemporary discussions. And so, it's always important to understand what he was driving at and what he contributed to the continuing discussions about what rule of law means.
One of the interesting aspects of your essay is that you tease out some of the distinctions between the way Dicey thought about the rule of law and the way we tend to use the term today. Can you elaborate a little bit for our viewers who either haven't had a chance to read the essay yet or perhaps would like to hear a little bit more elaboration on this? How did Dicey view rule of law differently than the way we use the term today?
So today, the rule of law means a lot of different things to different people. It's often used internationally in these sort of rule of law indexes to sort of mean basic rights given to people, rights of free speech, peaceful transfers of power, for instance, definitely this a subject of discussion now, to show basically a constitutional system has consistency and universality. And this was a similar sort of conception to what Dicey thought of as the rule of law. Rule of law, as one of his heroes, William Blackstone, said, didn't mean an arbitrary rule. It was something consistent and universally applied. It was something that was also prescriptive. It wasn't something that happened after the event. But one of the important parts that Dicey contributed, that is so much distinctive from today, especially as the debate goes around in America, is he was less concerned about the idea of separation of powers. In fact, he was a little suspicious of it. He came from an English constitutional tradition where basically all the powers were resident in Parliament. Parliament can do anything it wants. As a famous quote said, Parliament can do anything but turn a man into a woman. And as I say today, with contemporary technology, it could absolutely do that. It could do that in a second if it wanted to. So there was no constraints on that. And he was less concerned about this sort of ability to constrain a single sovereign like Parliament than he was about the equality of law before all individuals. Something that became more important in America later in the 19th century, but Dicey was one of the earliest to formulate this idea that law should apply to all equally. Now, why he saw that was so important was that he saw numerous individuals escape prosecution or escape this sort of equal protection of the law. What they had was, he saw someone like Governor Edward Ayer, who was a governor of Jamaica, who brutally put down a rebellion of black residents there and killed many of them. And most people understood that he did so illegally, that there was no law prosecuting it. And one of Dicey's other heroes, John Stuart Mill, said, well, if we can't prosecute the head of this governorship, the law doesn't apply equally. And one of the conceptions of Blackstone and Everett is that what is universal, it applies to the very top and it applies to the very bottom. So this was the focus of Dicey's sort of real, the Grabman is his concern about rule of law, and why he thought it was so important in the Anglo-American tradition that the officers of the government, everyone from a member of parliament down to an individual civil servant, could be prosecuted just like a normal citizen, and they were subject to the law just anyone else. When we talk about rule of law in America and administrative law, which was one of Dicey's main issues, that's less of an issue, this idea that, well, we need to hold government officials to account. But this was very central to Dicey's whole conception of what was distinctive about Anglo-American jurisprudence.
And I hope we'll get a chance to talk a little bit about how that manifested itself through what became qualified immunity for government officials here in the U.S. a little later on. But I wanted to ask you one quick question that you mentioned in your essay, this importance of procedure in Dicey's thought, or, you know, the sort of notion coming from Bentham about the importance of procedure. Can you elaborate a little bit on how procedure works as a key component for rule of law for Dicey?
Yeah, so one of his other heroes, I'm mentioning a bunch of heroes, but he did have a few, and they were all important in formulating his thoughts, was Jeremy Bentham. Now, Jeremy Bentham, ironically, was sort of the counterpoint to William Blackstone. William Blackstone, a famous professor of law, created this conception of the common law as this gradual evolution towards this near-perfect system. And Jeremy Bentham thought the common law was just a big mess of unruly ideas that weren't synchronized and systematized. But what Bentham did think was that, well, the most important part about law is procedure. How do you get from step A to step B to step C? You don't have something like, he was less concerned about, say, well, someone has a free speech right. So to him, that was less important, the idea, well, how do you enforce it? What does a free speech right mean? If someone abrogates your free speech right, what happens? Do they get an injunction preventing them from doing it? Do they get prosecuted for doing it? It really matters. In fact, what both Dicey and Bentham thought, it's the only thing that matters is how do you enforce these sort of rules. As I think Justice Scalia said it at one point, you know, every tin pot dictator and constitution over in authoritarian countries had all these rights written in their constitution. That's much less important than, well, what does it mean in practice? How do you actually enforce it? How does someone get into court to mean that right becomes enforced? And so Dicey said that one of the geniuses of the British Constitution, which he thought was largely inherited in America, was that these procedures were the entire base of it. The assumption of freedom was a sort of baseline. It wasn't in England, they didn't have a formal Bill of Rights. They had some statutes that were like Bill of Rights from 1689 and so forth. But the most important thing is they took freedom baseline. So, well, how do we protect that freedom? And the most of the genius of English legal history was, well, what are the procedures that allow that freedom to get it become enforced? And he said one of the most important parts was, well, you can take a government civil servant who took away your free speech or arrested you for saying wrong, and you could sue them. You could say, look, you arrested me for speaking my mind, so let's just take you into court and I can penalize you, an official of the government. He thought this was a wonderful and important thing, and he thought the procedures that existed in, say, France didn't have that same ability to hold government officials to account. So this understanding of the importance of something that's seemingly less sort of headline grabbing, but the absolute essentiality of getting procedure right in terms of getting all the sort of rights and enforcement and powers and rule of law correct, was so central to Dicey's ideas.
Is his emphasis on, and you mentioned this, contract versus status, if I'm remembering this correctly. So there's a piece between the notion that, and this comes from Bentham and Maynard, that the contract conception is basically that this is the way you apply these principles across everyone. There's a sort of implicit contract versus the idea that your status dictates. Is that status exclusively, was Dicey exclusively interested in it from the standpoint of politicians or policymakers or government officials, or was it more of a social status piece as well that would have applied to, say, his period in England, where you've got a much more hierarchical society and the concern that people in society would be treated differently based on their social standing as well?
Yeah, it was both in a sense. So he was taking these ideas from both, as you mentioned, Bentham and his friend Henry Maine, who was a famous legal historian, that the whole history of English law was a movement from status to contract. And like the original English law gave a lot of weight to status. If you were a king or you were an aristocrat, you were subject to different laws and different rules and different sorts of procedures than your average citizen was. But what Maine was showing is that over the history of English law, there was this gradual movement from this inequality, this up and down, whether that was an aristocrat versus a peasant, or later became a civil servant versus a mere member of society, and became something where, well, everyone became subject eventually to the same sorts of laws. And he was concerned about both. Early in his career, he was very concerned about kind of lingering exemptions of the aristocracy from the full weight of the law. Later on, he became concerned about both, as I mentioned before, the exemption of some civil servants from law, which was common in France and became more common in England, but also the exemption of some things like trade unions. In the 1906 Trade Disputes Act exempted trade unions from certain types of liability for their actions. And he thought this both, it could be different parts of the hierarchy. So in some cases it could be, again, someone, a working class individual in a trade union is exempt. In other cases it could be an aristocrat or the governor of Jamaica who appeared to be exempt. In both those cases he said, no, you want absolute equality before the law, and that was essential.
So I want to pick up on the trade disputes point, because this is something I wanted to ask. When I read that piece of that part of your essay, I was struck by how much that seemed like the creation of a government privilege, mm-hmm. or what an economist would call rent. And then, of course, that leads to the pursuit of those rents as through government privilege by lobbying and other sorts of activities. And then at that point, I was confused, because it seems at that point like rule of law is a much broader concept, right? It's not merely applying these laws; it's also how the laws are written, right? So can you help me work through, or maybe help our viewers think a little bit through, is rule of law like so broad as to include the way that the way that government proactively is going to write? It's got to include both the way we think about future laws, but it could include things like economic privilege or other sorts of things, not merely this notion that government officials can't be persecuted for illegal acts. It could be advantages. It could be other sorts of statuses or privileges, social or economic, as well as that protection from criminal prosecution.
Yeah, they're certainly related. So one of the strands of Dicey that was later picked up by sort of more conservative and libertarian legal scholars was the idea of this equality before law. And I often think of Friedrich Hayek, who said that if you could have one law or one constitutional principle, it would be that all laws should apply equally to everybody. And so obviously this is something that warmed Dicey's heart. The real concern was that, yeah, some people got different exemptions or special privileges of the law. Now, Dicey was less concerned about something like, well, you take money from A and give it to B. You just tax orange merchants and give it to apple merchants. He didn't like that. He was a laissez-faire individual. But as a constitutional principle, it didn't bother him as much. And there always can be some sort of, you know, justification for why the government does that. And he thought that was acceptable. What he thought was distinctive about something like the Trades Dispute Act and why it raised his ire so much and why he became almost obsessed with it in his later years was that these people couldn't be taken to court. And now, again, maybe this seems like a sort of secondary issue between giving sort of a bunch of money to trade unions or giving them separate sort of power, delegated powers under, for instance, in America, the Wagner Act. But what he thought was essential is that basically it destroyed that equality of law and disrupted the idea that everybody is responsible for their own actions. If you can't be prosecuted, there's an irresponsibility that is created, and that can be created among civil servants or it can be created among trade unions. And that's why the Trade Union Dispute Act and similar laws were passed in the 1930s and 1940s in America regarding trade unions, such as the Hobbs Act, really were found to be a fundamental breach of the Anglo-American tradition.
And is that because of that inability to get that procedural piece that we talked about a little bit earlier? You can't take these individuals to court. You can't get the kind of relief that you would be able to get in a system that has that sort of procedure and that sort of systematic set of rules?
Yeah, no, exactly. It was that same sort of procedural focus from Bentham that, like, well, how do I punish someone if I get hurt by a trade union? A trade union advocates the busting up of my shop or factory or something. How do I get them to stop doing that? That's one of the things that really worried him. Now, again, he was against a lot of the benefits given to trade unions and to other groups of the period. He was against the high taxes. In another one of his books, the lectures on the relation between law and public opinion in England, he showed this sort of gradual move as he saw a degradation away from the laissez-faire tradition of his youth. But it didn't concern him constitutionally. Like, there were certain things that he saw as constitutionally fundamental for the rest of society to function. And that sort of exemption and that inability to use procedure legally was absolutely fundamental for him.
I wasn't going to ask this, but you've raised this twice now. So for him, there's a distinction between the market and the constant, or I guess there's a distinction between the sort of focus on laissez-faire economics and constitutionalism. I don't tend to think of those things as being separate, but Dicey did?
Yeah, I would say so. So it's, you know, he had policy preferences. He certainly, and again, that lectures on the relationship between law and public opinion, he made those abundantly clear that, listen, England in 1860s, 1860s England was about as close to utopia as Dicey felt that human society and its fragility was going to get. They basically got it right, he thought. And laissez-faire was important for that. He didn't think that was a constitutional issue. Just like today, we could say be very, very much opposed to, a 39 as opposed to a 32% tax rate or whatever it is. But most people wouldn't think it was a fundamental constitutional objection. So he thought both were essential. He just kind of put them in different sort of categories that constitution, keeping that stable and foundational was more important than any of his sort of policy preferences. Now, those policy preferences are very strong, and there's a long debate in the literature about how much Dicey kind of imported those laissez-faire preferences over into his constitutional analysis, and he clearly did to some extent. But he was able, you know, like a good legal scholar, to keep those somewhat separate. You know, there were times when, his constitutional ideas wouldn't synchronize perfectly with his policy preferences. But, he saw that as a job to elaborate those.
Well, let's move on from that to this question that you raised about separation of powers and then how he viewed America. Because in his book, as you said, he's focused on Britain and the United States as contrasted with France. So he was skeptical about separation of powers. Can you explain a little bit to our viewers what's the basis for that skepticism, and particularly whether or not that sort of skepticism has manifested itself positively or negatively over the years?
Yeah, so he was contrasting his work a little bit with a work by Walter Badgett, one of the founders of the Economist magazine, who in his book, The English Constitution, really contrasted the English Constitution with America and said, listen, the English Constitution is perfect, it's flexible, it's Parliament is important. There's not all of these either rigid federalisms, meaning a lot of different states allied together under federal government, or these rigid separation of powers. Dicey was trying to move away from that conception. He liked the English focus of all power and in Parliament. And he was suspicious of the American system that had separation of powers and separate executive, judicial, and legislative. But he saw the other constitutional ideas, the universal rule of law, the equality before the law, a strict, some clear constitution that elaborated how these different rules were enforced, as more of uniting the American and British system. And he contrasted himself and the Anglo-American tradition mainly with the French tradition. But he did think that what he blamed on American federalism, this idea is if you have a bunch of different independent sovereigns operating under a separate sovereignty, by its very nature, you need a rigid constitution and you need something that describes how these different constitutional entities are going to interact. And he saw a separate side effect of that was that you also had continuing this federalism principle even into the government itself. So the executive was separate from the legislative and separate from the judicial. So he thought that that was an unfortunate thing. He liked the idea that Parliament had total power, and he had no problem with delegating that power even. He said, well, you know, in England, a railroad corporation could arrest you, and they could set rules that allowed you to be arrested on the railroad for disobeying railroad laws. He had no problem with that whatsoever. He saw the American system as well. The American system can't delegate some things to the executive to decide on basic rules, and that's an unfortunate. Now, later on in his career, he became a little more sympathetic to the American position, that he became a little suspicious that too much legislative authority was being delegated over to the executive. And he at least thought that the legislative could provide a check on sort of arbitrary executive rulemaking. But on the whole, the separation of powers just wasn't an animating part of his belief. And, you know, that came from his English tradition, which, as he thought, worked pretty well. They didn't have separation of powers in England. And, you know, there was no problem with it. I figure you might ask me about the sort of issue, well, what about the judiciary? Like, well, the judiciary has to be separate to control the parliament and create this procedures and rule of law that he thought that was so important. Now, there is a potential sort of conflict there, but he thought as long as the parliament set the rules and the judiciary enforced them, he thought that wasn't so much as a separation of powers as
sort of a delegation of authority.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the delegation of authority, and they could do that. And it was as long as prospective, the parliament set those rules and then the judiciary carried them out, then it was okay. He still thought the judiciary needed to be independent, but independent from the executive was his main concern. Now, so he thought separation of powers like they had in France. I mean, look, they had a separate court for the executive, basically. The executive had its own courts where they dealt with that whole thing, and he thought that was separation of powers kind of taken to its fullest extent. The executive is totally independent from someone. And he liked the idea, and even though we often conflate the two, of what we maybe see is a little more checks and balances. The judiciary is a check on the executive. And in his mind, like where you have the executive totally separate from other one, that's too much separation of powers.
I wonder how much of that is a result of the English tradition of sort of thinking of parliament vis-a-vis the sovereign. Whereas in the United States, you've got a whole different conception of the way that of the concerns about where power is delegated within the government itself. The government is the greater concern, but of course, in the English tradition, it's a little bit different. I've been waiting towards the latter half of the interview, latter part of the interview, to bring up this topic. But you know, the events of the past year regarding police activity and qualified immunity. Let's talk a little bit about that and how Dicey serves as at least an early influence on the way the United States thinks about that. And then what happens in terms of the departure from that concern about granting that concern about giving too much authority to government officials. Where does qualified immunity come from in the American system? Does Dicey play any role in trying to put limits on it? And what role does he play in the history of this evolution?
Yeah, so if you look at early American cases against civil servants, there's nothing like qualified immunity. And that's exactly how Dicey would like it. That if you look at someone like Jerry Mashow's The Hidden History of the Administrative State, not the exact title, but his book they're describing the early years of American constitutionalism and administrative law. Well, if a civil servant grabbed your stuff and took it in, even though he was ordered to by his authorities and by his superiors, and even though he had a regulation that he thought he could point to that was reasonable, you could take that official into law and prosecute him individually for abusing your stuff, just like you could if a private citizen came into your house and took your stuff, even though he thought he had a reasonable reason to do so. All of those things were enforced in rule of law. Now, what happened later in America is that prosecutions of government officials, especially after the 1960s, started to grow very rapidly because of a few cases, often based on very legitimate concerns of inability to hold state officials to account, often for racially biased policing or racially biased enforcement. And the government began widening the scope of how we can prosecute officials. Now, at the same time, the government, the judiciary tried to kind of put an ad hoc or post hoc cabin or limit on these prosecutions or cases, these lawsuits, by saying, well, an official has a qualified immunity against cases, which basically meant that if he was doing it and he thought it was reasonable and it was based on a reasonable conception of the laws that then stood, he can't be brought to bear. He can't be brought before a court and before a jury. And this is, right now we debate this all the time with police cases. A policeman shoots an individual, someone sues the policeman for endangering their health and well-being as an assault, basically. And a court will say, well, it's qualified immunity. He thought he had to shoot them. He was under orders to shoot them, so on and so forth. And it's a very new principle in American law. It only happened basically post 1970s, 1980s. And one of the things that I was also trying to bring up to the court is we've almost entirely lost this idea outside the police, who are the subject of intense debate, that you know an official could be brought to suit for, say, oh, I need to inspect your house or jump into your barber shop and appropriate your stuff, or I need to you know, something like civil asset forfeiture or something like a simple inspection or fine in your business. You can't bring that person to suit. Now, you can sue the government, maybe, and maybe go through the normal case too, but you can't sue that individual. And, you know, what Dicey thought is that upset the whole balance. Like, he thought the balance was towards liberty when you could hold an individual to account. Like, as long as you were just holding the government to account, there was no individual that was fully accountable. You always had that sense of the individual civil servant or officer of the law felt immune, and because of the sense he would be, and he is, from carrying out these actions. And that tips that balance of procedure back towards more government action and more imposition on the lives of everyday citizens, and away from that sort of careful evaluation of rights and the independence of property and individual safety and so on that he saw as so essential.
I mean, it moves us away from that it moves us back towards a status model, away from a contract model, and to use your language in the essay, right? So that the government individual is placed at a status higher than that of the common citizen. And so when she enters your barbershop or she enters your restaurant or whatever and engages in the sorts of activities you just pursued, she's got a higher standard, or the standards are held differently. And so there's not that equality before.
And so exactly. And this was that concern, that exemption of government officers from that. That same liability was the Grafman's whole concern about the rule of law's complaints about the erosion of it. And so, yeah, it's, you know, I I get angry at you and I punch you, as I often do, Pat. And when we're in a, you know, nice heated argument, and you can, you know, bring me into suit, and you can throw the book at me, and the jury can fine me for it. But if I'm a police officer doing it, and my maybe boss told me to do it, well, then I'm potentially exempt from that same suit. And yeah, that's a different. Now we're on different planes. We're not two citizens interacting equally in a court of law. We're a government official, and we're a normal citizen. And that's a return to status that he thought the British and Anglo-American tradition had avoided or moved away from in the past 200-300 years.
It would be interesting to see how Dicey would view these sorts of discussions today. I'll finish up by just asking you, is there a Diceyan solution to our current dilemma? I mean, other than sort of abolishing these privileges, what would Dicey suggest? Would he suggest moving towards a procedure-based solution to this problem? Would he suggest more of a legislative solution where the laws are changed? Are these two things that have to be pursued together?
So both, I think. So, I mean, since qualified immunity is a judicially created idea, the judiciary could certainly change it. But now it's become so interwoven in so many laws and statutes and ideas about government regulation, you'd probably have to have the legislative branch change a lot of this to really create a fundamentally different conception of the interaction between civil servants or government officers and citizens. But the other thing that could definitely be done would definitely be either the courts changing this, the contemporary rulings on this, or the legislator abrogating it, is administrative law judges. Now, this is something I haven't talked about before and only tangentially mentioned in the piece, but the idea that you would have a separate judge that would rule just on government cases was also anathema to Dicey, because that was that same fundamental, what? Yeah. And the abrogation of your ability to get a fair and independent judge. If the SEC, when it's enforcing a fine against a stockbroker or something, can go before its own administrative law judge, that it controls and then it can fire and then it can ultimately overrule even, well, that's not the procedure that allows the equal pursuit of justice. That's not a procedure that allows everyone equality before the law. And there are all these administrative law judges in different agencies and different commissions. And that was the sort of thing that would really get Dicey's ire. Like that used to be one of the major parts of administrative law discussions. Like, what do we do with these administrative law judges? Right now, people are obsessed with delegation, and there's plenty of legitimate concerns about that we've talked about, the delegation of lawmaking authority. But like the ability to have these judges that were able to just rule on things that the government brought, rule on things the government therefore could determine the outcome, basically, then this is not an independent rule of law. It's not prospective. It's not an independent arbitrator between different bodies. It's the government deciding its own cases. And that's something that the government can change step by step. Take away those administrative law judges' independent authority to prosecute citizens and decide cases.
But of course, that raises the question why the government would choose to do that. And that's a deeper sort of philosophical question, sort of beyond the scope of what we've explored today. Judge, I want to thank you for taking time out of your day to discuss these issues. Thanks for a great essay and a great set of responses. I'm looking forward to talking to the other authors, but thank you for starting us off with a great interview, and I appreciate your contribution to Liberty Matters.
Thanks so much, Pat.